Fine, so today we are going to start this chapter, Thermal Properties of Matter. Okay, so this is the first chapter of study of heat and its phenomena. Getting it? Now, this is the entire section in physics where you study about thermal properties of matter, then you learn about how you convert heat energy into work in thermodynamics, okay, and then you get into the details of exactly how the velocity of molecules can contribute to pressure or can contribute to energy. Okay, so you exactly get to know what are the micro factors, what is happening because of which the temperature is increased for a particular substance. So all that will constitute inside a big chunk of your class 11, which is thermodynamics, thermal properties of matter, and kinetic theory of gases. Alright, so this constitutes in and around 10 to 15% of your let's say JEE syllabus as such. Okay, so a good number of questions come from this section. Alright, and the best part is what? It's very easy. Okay, and that's probably the another reason why students take it for granted, and they will be like, okay, I'll be doing it at the end, let me do the difficult part first. What happens because of that is your difficult part never improves and you lose out on the easy part also. Okay, so make sure you are very good at thermodynamics, which is probably the easiest section of your class 11th. Fine. So be very attentive in class. Anywhere, whenever you have doubt, please feel free to ask. Okay, make sure you are very, very good at this entire section. Okay, this study of heat and its phenomena, this has been done for ages now. In fact, when people have started understanding about physics as a branch, they have studied first about the heavenly objects like stars, sun and all that. So astronomy was considered to be the oldest branch of science, okay, and later on when the fire was discovered and they came to know something, heat is one of a form of energy, then the study of heat also picked up. Okay, the study of mechanics, study of the motion of object and then study of rigid body and all that came much later on. Okay, so thermodynamics is one of the oldest branch of science where we study the heat and its phenomena. Okay, so the first chapter in that series, write down, is thermal properties of matter. You will see in your book number 2, you are essentially learning about properties of different things. First chapter is what? Mechanical properties of solids. Then what? Mechanical properties of fluids. Now, thermal properties of matter. So we are not studying thermal properties of solids separately and thermal properties of liquids separately. Okay? Because with respect to thermal properties, they are behaving in a similar way. Fine. So entire matter's thermal property is what we are going to learn in this particular chapter. Okay. Now, can you tell me, first of all, tell me, what do we mean by property? Property means what? Like, for example, what's your name?
Aditya.
Like, so suppose if I talk about what are the properties of Aditya, so what will come in my mind as in something which is very specific to Aditya, isn't it? Right. I'll not say that Aditya is a student. Okay, that's the generic thing. So when I say property of anything, a specific thing will come in my mind. Alright, so now when I say thermal properties of matter, thermal properties of matter, so what should come in your mind? Something which get affected by something related to heat or temperature. Getting it? Some properties that are related with heat and temperature. Can you tell me few properties which are related to heat and temperature for a particular substance? Think of pressure of a gas is related with the temperature. Okay, what else? Volume. Does it depend on the temperature? Does it change? If I change the temperature, does volume change? It changes, right? So expansion of an object is a thermal property. Okay, that we are going to learn in this particular section. Okay, so write down property number one. The first property, this is what thermal properties of matter. So we are just listing down what are those thermal properties. Okay. The first property is thermal expansion. So we will get into the details of it. Right now we are just focusing on what could be the properties that we should focus on. Okay, so this is one of the properties. Any doubt here? Okay, it says that whenever you heat any object, increase its temperature, its volume will increase. Alright, what else can you think of? Anything else? This is the first property. Second one, the temperature is the cause. Okay, now see why this thermal expansion is a property. Because two different substances will expand differently for a given change in temperature. Are you getting it? So it's a unique property. Expansion of one object is different from the other object for a given temperature change. So that is why it is a property. Had it been that all the objects expand equally with the same amount of temperature change, then it is not a property of a object. Are you getting it? Now can you think of any other property other than thermal expansion?
State.
Now what do you mean by state? States of matter, liquid, gas or solid. Now is that a thermal property? If I let's say heat up an object, a solid object, will its state change after some time? Depends, but then it will eventually convert into liquid, isn't it? And then it will convert into vapor, like what happens with water. It's ice and then it melts and then evaporates, and that happens because you're giving it heat, right? Now can you tell me, is that a property of a substance? Can two substances, they require different amount of heat to change their states, right? They require, like for example, if you heat an iron object, it will require much more heat to melt than melting ice. Getting it? So state change is second property. So what I mean by state change is solid converting into liquid and then converting into vapor. Different amount of heat is required to change the state from one state to the other state for different objects. So that is why it is a property. Now can you think of any other property? Third property. Just think aloud. I mean, it's okay if you're wrong. What? What do you mean by heat capacity?
The amount of heat required to raise the temperature multiplied by one degree.
Okay. Now suppose you have two objects. Okay, if I give, let's say, same amount of heat to both the objects, will the change in temperature be same? Should it be same for both the objects? Not necessary, right? Suppose you give, let's say, 5 joules of heat to a very good conductor of heat, okay, its temperature will immediately increase. Okay, but if you give the same amount of heat to a bad conductor of heat, it will not increase very fast. You're getting it? So there has to be some term defined which takes care of the fact, as in how much heat is required to increase the temperature. Are you getting it? So the best way to quantify this property is heat required per degree change in temperature, which will be different for different objects. Yes or no? Right? And that property, heat required to change per degree temperature, is heat capacity. Fine? So the third property is heat capacity. Write down. This is heat required divided by however much temperature has risen because of that. Alright? A different object will have different heat capacity. Okay? We will come back to specific heat capacity later on. Right now we are just defining heat capacity. That is more generic than specific heat capacity. Okay? Now can you think of fourth property now? Property number 4. What do you think it should be? Change in energy is taken care by this. Latent heat is taken care by this. Latent heat is required to change the state. That will be different for different objects. Okay. Fourth property. I just give you a hint. Suppose you are cooking food in a copper utensil, or suppose you are cooking food in stainless steel. Where the food will be cooked faster? Copper one. How fast heat is conducted from one point to the other point. Is that a property? That is a property, right? For example, if there is some hot object, if you try to touch it through an iron rod, the heat will conduct to you at a much faster rate than if you just poke it with a bad conductor of heat. You're getting it? So how fast heat is getting conducted, that itself is a property of a substance. Okay? So the fourth property is heat transfer. Which is nothing but rate of transfer of heat energy. Okay? Any doubts? So these are the four properties that we are going to learn in this chapter one by one. Okay? So we will take property number one initially. Okay? But before getting into property, we need to first understand what is temperature, right? And what is heat, and how they are different from each other. Can you tell me what is temperature? What it is?
A measure of hotness or coldness.
What do you mean by that? Measure of hotness means what?
To give it a specific value. Heat is just energy, but whereas temperature specifies the value.
No, but heat can also be specified, right? Heat is energy, so it can be written in the form of joules.
It's relative. Temperature is
a flow of energy.
Heat is a flow of energy. Heat flows, or heat goes, heat energy goes from one object to the other object. Okay? Just like water flows from one point to the other point. Why water flows from one point to other point? Because of the pressure difference. Right? Because of the pressure difference, water flows. And because of the temperature difference, heat flows. Okay? So you can draw parallel with let's say fluids and try to understand it. Okay, and if you go to the micro level, as in what it is exactly. Okay, suppose gas molecules are there in this room. Okay, I am talking about what is heat. I mean, what happens to the gas molecule if the temperature increases? If the temperature increases, the kinetic energy of gas molecule increases. Okay. So what happens is that when a gas molecule hit your hand, then it will transfer its little bit of kinetic energy into your hand. Okay? And you'll feel the heat. Getting it? So if there's a lot of transfer of energy from the gas molecule on your hands, you'll feel that more amount of heat is there. Are you getting it? Now, temperature is a measure of, indirectly it is a measure of how much is the kinetic energy in the gas, right? More is the kinetic energy in the gas, more it can transfer. Are you getting it? So temperature in a way is a measure of kinetic energy of the gas molecules. Okay, now what is pressure? Pressure also happens because of gas molecules. What is that? When the force gets exerted, when the gas molecule collide, okay, they will not only transfer the energy, they will transfer the momentum also. Fine, that transfer of momentum creates a force. Rate of change of momentum creates a force, and that creates a pressure. And the transfer of energy creates the flow of heat. Getting it? Now, the problem is that we cannot go about looking at the gas molecule and then try to say that, okay, temperature is, I mean, rather than temperature, you best way was that you just find out the kinetic energy of the molecules, all of it, and then say that, okay, just forget about temperature, this is the kinetic energy. But it becomes a very tedious process and inaccurate process. Fine. So there is this term called temperature, which is defined, coined, which tells you, you know, relatively what is the kinetic energy of the molecules. Getting it? Alright? So, this is what the temperature is, and there had been lot of research, as in past, to just, quantify what it is. Because during those days, people were trying to quantify each and everything defined. Like for example, length. Length was quantified. Okay, this much is 1 meter, this much is probably 1 feet, like that they have quantified. Okay, and similarly they have quantified mass, time, and everything they have quantified. But when it comes to something like temperature, they were not able to quantify it very well. The reason is that when I say zero length, what does it mean? 0 meters means nothing is there. Less than zero length is not possible. Getting it? Similarly, less than 0 kg is not possible. So there is absolute zero there. You cannot go below that. Right? Similarly, you need to define the temperature in such a way that zero means zero. Are you getting it? But nobody was able to find during that time what is zero, what is absolute zero. Fine. So that is the reason why they could not identify an absolute scale. So they took the help of the most common thing available to everyone, which is what? Water. Okay? And with respect to water, they have come up with a scale to measure the temperature. Is this thing understood? Right? So, but then when they have defined, they will assume something to be zero. They will say, okay, fine, well, the water freezes at 0 degrees Celsius. But is less than zero possible? Yes, it is possible. So that zero is not absolute zero. Are you getting it? That's just a relative zero. It is zero with respect to the water at that level. Getting it? So, degree Celsius scale is defined. Write down. This temperature scale is defined . See what happens is, when you know the absolute scale, for example, for length, we know 0 is 0. So all you have to do is define what is 1 meter. Then 2 meter is double of that, 3 meter is triple of that, like that. It becomes straightforward thing. But when it comes to relative scale, you need to first assume what is 0, and then you have to assume what is 1. Get it? So, the assumption here is that, write down, the temperature of ice is assumed to be 0 degrees Celsius. Just like you assume gravitation potential energy to be 0 at some horizontal level, even though it is not. Getting it? Like that, we are assuming something to be 0 degrees Celsius, which is temperature of ice. Okay, and then we are assuming temperature of boiling water to be 100 degrees Celsius. All this is happening at 1 atmosphere. Fine. Okay, and between ice and this boiling point, entire scale is divided into 100 equal parts. Okay, so it's a linear scale, fine, equally spaced intervals from 0 to 100. Any doubts? Now, if I have defined a scale like this, can you get an idea of what is 150? You just move one step, whatever you have defined, you know exactly what is 1, right? So after 100, you just add 50 of 1s. So you get 150, right? So that's how Celsius scale is defined. Okay? And then, during the same time, in England, there was this Fahrenheit scale that was developed. Degree Fahrenheit, I call it. Fahrenheit scale. Here, they have taken some other basis. They haven't taken water. I'm not actually very sure what basis they had taken, but they have taken the basis in such a way that the temperature of melting ice, this is melting ice, okay? This is melting ice, because ice can be at less than 0 degrees Celsius also, but melting ice has to be at 0. Okay, so temperature of melting ice is 32 degree Fahrenheit. Okay, and temperature of boiling water, any idea what it is? Remember? No? 212. Degree Fahrenheit. Okay? Any doubts till now? No? Both are linear scale. As in, between 32 and 212, what is the difference? 212 and 32? 180? Right? So 180 equal divisions are there. Here 100 equal divisions are there. Okay? Now, if I tell you a temperature in degree Celsius, can you convert into Fahrenheit or vice versa? Can you do that? Try to see whether you can derive it. Assume that temperature in degree Celsius scale is C. What is F? Anyone, how will you go about it? Any idea?
Yeah.
Acha, tell me this. If I plot this graph, suppose on y-axis you have Fahrenheit and on x-axis you have degree Celsius. Okay? Will it be a straight line? Will it be a straight line? It has to be. Both are linear scales. Okay, both are linear scale, so there will be a straight line equation between F and C. Okay, can you find out the line? Can you plot a line? Do that. You have 2 points, right?
We can just find the slope.
Yeah. I mean that's the way you have to do it. Since it is a straight line, the slope should be same. Try to do this. What is the first point? When degree Celsius is 0, Fahrenheit is 32. So this is the first point. 0, 32. Okay. Second point. 212, 100, 212. So this point is 100, 212. Fine. So you have this as your straight line. Fine. Now, since it is a straight line, the slope should be constant, right? So you just assume a random point somewhere here whose coordinates are C, F. Okay? Take these 2 points initially and then these 2 points. Equate the slope from 2 point formula. This is A, B, and C. So if you take A and C, the slope should be 212 minus 32 divided by 100 minus 0. This should be equal to F minus 32 divided by C minus 0. Any doubt? So we have F minus 32 divided by 180 is equal to C by 100. Okay? C is equal to 5 by 9 F minus 32. Right, so this is how you can, you know, derive a relation between degree Celsius and Fahrenheit. Any doubts? So if I give you a temperature in degree Celsius, you should be able to convert in degree Celsius with this formula. Now people didn't stop there. They were always trying to find out, is there any absolute scale? Okay, so in that particular quest, there was one experiment that was conducted with gases. Okay, so let's see what is that experiment. This is the temperature and this one is the pressure. Okay. Now they have taken a gas at a particular pressure and temperature. So this is the initial pressure and temperature. Okay, now they are cooling it down. What will happen to its temperature? Down. Pressure down. Okay, so next point is observed. Okay, then again they are cooling it down, another point is observed. So like that, when they are connecting it, they are getting like this, a straight line, and after this point the gas liquefies, it changes the state. Fine, but if you extend the line, you know that pressure cannot be less than zero. Okay, so when pressure is zero, they are trying to find what could have been the temperature. So this gas liquefied because it's a real gas, it's not an ideal gas. Had it been the ideal gas, it will not liquefy and it will just come and hit here. And this temperature is minus of 273.15 degrees Celsius. Okay, now this is for only one gas, let's say gas 1. Okay, similarly they have taken another gas. Alright, now when they have taken another gas, there also they are trying to liquefy it, they are trying to decrease the temperature. So its temperature decreased and then to their surprise it came and meet the same point. When pressure is zero, the temperature of both the gases appear to be at same point. Okay. Which gas you take, approximately all the gases, they are converging at the same temperature, as if there is something unique for that temperature. something unique about this temperature. Okay, what is that unique thing? Temperature cannot go below this, because negative pressure is not defined. It's not possible. Fine. So if temperature cannot go below this, what does it mean? This is the absolute temperature. This is the absolute zero. Okay, so there comes a new scale, which is an absolute scale. So since it is an absolute scale, we don't call it degree. Degree is a relative term, like degree Celsius, degree Fahrenheit. It's a relative comparison with some substance. Kelvin is not a comparison, it's an absolute scale. Okay, so a Kelvin scale is defined. Write down Kelvin temperature scale. Is defined in such a way that 0 Kelvin is actually minus of 273.15 degree Celsius. Sorry, yeah. 0 Kelvin is this. And 'change in temperature in Kelvin, delta, as in 1 Kelvin, is change of 1 Kelvin is equal to change of 1 degree Celsius. Getting it? So delta T in Kelvin is equal to delta T in degree Celsius. They are equal. Fine? So you will see a lot of formulas in this chapter where delta T will come. Okay? So you don't need to convert degree Celsius into Kelvin or Kelvin to degree Celsius, because both delta T's are same. Okay? But if suppose there is a formula in which only T is coming, like sigma E A T raised to power 4, there is no delta T. There you need to convert temperature into Kelvin, which is an absolute scale. Okay? This happens to the to be the SI unit also for temperature, Kelvin. Okay, any doubts? No. Now can you tell me, if the temperature is C degree Celsius, or let's say X degree Celsius, what is its temperature in Kelvin? How much that should be? X plus 273.15. Okay. So this much temperature in degree Celsius is equivalent to X plus 273.15 Kelvin. Okay, and just so that our calculation is simpler, we many times ignore 0.15. We just say 273. We just add 273 degree Celsius to arrive at the SI unit of the temperature, which is Kelvin. Fine? Any doubt with introduction to temperature? Right? So this is how we measure the temperature. Once you know how you can measure the temperature, now you can talk about the thermal properties one by one. Okay? Now, like what we have discussed, you know, you can devise your own way of measuring temperature. You can have a gas trapped inside a container, and you can define in such a way temperature that pressure when ice is melting at that temperature, you know, that pressure corresponds to some temperature, and that boiling water, what is the pressure inside that container, correspond to some other temperature. So you can develop and scale yourself. Getting my point? Okay, so don't feel afraid of solving such questions, because if you go and solve some higher level questions, they will twist the question in such a way that many times you assume that, okay, fine, this is Kelvin scale, this is degree Celsius scale, this is Fahrenheit scale, and that's it. But what happens is that a good question will test you on the basics, whether you have understood how the scales are defined. They will give a scenario in such a way that they'll say, okay, assume there is a new temperature scale that has developed. So this is our condition. So you need to be very good at analyzing the situation. Right? But then that will come through problem practice. We'll do it a bit later. Right now, our focus is property number one, which is thermal expansion. Write down. This is a property of every substance, and it says that the substance, write down, the substance will expand, okay, substance will expand if the temperature of the substance is increased, if the temperature of the substance is increased. What will happen to a substance if the temperature is decreased? It will contract. Okay, so whatever was the situation before, it will come back to that. Fine. So this is what we are going to learn. Now, when I say expand, expansion, what do you mean by that? Expansion is what? Expansion of length, expansion of width, expansion of area, or expansion of volume. What do you mean? Expansion of volume.
Space occupied.
Expansion of everything. All the dimensions. Each and every dimension will expand. Fine. Be it length, width, area, or volume. Everything will expand. Okay. So we will talk about it one by one. First, we'll take the most simplistic scenario, that is linear expansion. Okay. Write down linear expansion. And in a way, you know, area is nothing but multiplication of two linear dimensions. So if linear expansion is there, volume aerial expansion is anyway there. And if aerial expansion is there, volume anyway is there. Okay? So they are interlinked. Linear expansion. Have you learned a little bit about calculus? Little bit? Like for example, something is varying a curve sort of thing, then you assume a very very small interval, and then you say that in that small interval you can assume it to be linear even though it is a curve.
Yes.
Okay. Similarly here, the expansion is so less. Expansion is so less that you can assume that it changes linearly with the temperature. What I mean to say is that if you consider length, if you consider length L, if this length changes by delta L for delta T increase in temperature, if you change the temperature by 2 delta T, how much will be increase in length? 2 delta L. 2 delta L. Getting it? So you assume it to be sequential increase or linear increase with the temperature. Fine. Now let's get into a little bit more detail. Suppose I take a rod, let's say a rod has length L. Okay. You have provided heat to the rod and its temperature has changed from T naught. From T naught, its temperature has gone to T naught plus delta T. T naught plus delta T. So increase in temperature is delta T. And length is increased to L plus delta L. Okay. Now can you tell me this delta L, increase in the length, should be proportional to what? Delta T. Immediately that will come in your mind. delta T, it should be proportional to delta T. What else? Delta L should be proportional to what else? It should be like, it should depend on delta T, delta L should depend on material. Of course, because it is a property of a material, it has to depend on what is a material. Otherwise, it is not a property of substance. Okay? What else? Delta L depends on what else? That, does it depend on L also, delta L? If I take half the length, L by 2, will delta L be still the same or it will be different? If I just take L by 2 length, L by 2, okay? I divide this rod into L by 2 and L by 2, okay? If I increase the temperature, what should be the expansion here if delta L was initial? It should be delta L by 2 here,
yeah,
and delta L by 2 there. Are you getting it? Or let me give you a simpler way to visualize. You take a rubber band and you stretch it. If shorter the rubber band, same amount of force, small extension is there. Longer the rubber band, same amount of force, longer is the extension. Getting it? Each and every part will expand. This L by 2 will expand now. So each and every part here will expand, but the total length is L by 2 right now. So total expansion will be delta L by 2. So in a way, the expansion depends on the original length also. Fine? So delta L is proportional to whatever was the initial length. Let's call it as L naught. Fine? Now, these are the two mathematical relations, okay? So I can combine these two and I can say that delta L is proportional to L naught into delta T. I can say that, okay? Now, I'll put a proportionality constant, okay? I'll put a proportionality constant and I'll say that that proportionality constant is specific to the material. So this depends on material. This thing is taken care by the constant itself. Getting your point? So delta L is equal to L naught alpha delta T, where alpha is coefficient of linear expansion. Okay. Alpha is coefficient of linear expansion. It is typically of the order of 10 raised to minus 5. It is very, very less. And if you see the variation of alpha, let's say with temperature, this is alpha, it goes something like this, okay? So after 500 Kelvin, alpha becomes a constant. This proportionality constant, alpha, even though we are treating it a constant, it doesn't remain constant at a lesser temperature. It becomes constant after 500 Kelvin or so for a particular material itself. Okay, but then whenever we talk about thermal expansion, our temperature will be typically more than this. Okay, so until and unless specified, we will assume alpha is a constant for a given material. Any doubt? Now using this, let's say you have a rectangular plate. You have a rectangular plate of length L and width B. Fine. You are increasing the temperature by delta T. Okay. Coefficient of linear expansion is given as alpha. Okay. Initial area is what? L into B. L into B is the initial area. Find out the final area when temperature is increased by delta T. Try to derive it. What will happen to L? How much? Delta L will be L alpha delta T. Okay. So L will increase by delta L. What will happen to B? Increase by delta B. So B will increase little bit like this. So the new rectangle will be like this. Okay, so this much is the extra area that comes in because of the expansion. Fine. I want to find out what is, you know, new area in terms of LB, alpha and delta T. Assume alpha to be very less.